So I'm sorry.
Desculpe. Nós vamos, apresentar as pessoas que estão na mesa. Então, bom, aqui, Alice Mux vai ser a debatedora, depois nós vamos ter o Timothy Daniels, da Austria University, Sherry Malara, que também é da Austria University, o João Pacheco de Oliveira costuma desaparecer. Eu espero que ele retorne. A gente já sabe disso, ele sempre desaparece, às vezes volta. Espero que ele volte. E o Charles Harris da Universidade de Texas. Então, nós vamos começar então com o
Tim, que vai falar do Race in African International Studies Towards a Critical Immigration Studies. E você vai ter, Tim, you're going to have 20 minutes.
Good afternoon. I'd like to give a really deep and warm thanks to the kind invitation we've received from the organizers and the very nutritious lunch we just had as well. I'm going to cut down major sections of my paper, but I want to touch on some of the major points that will help us to move toward, hopefully, a more critical immigration studies. We need a critical theory of international migration that will explicate the role race and racism plays in the complicated processes of movements of people around the uneven terrain of global society. There's several approaches that I would like to incorporate into what's been called a city as context perspective, which combines urban history and urban anthropology, which can provide a broad framework for this critical international migration theory. This city as context approach considers each city as a particular socio, historic, and economic field molded by local, regional, national, and global forces. Bredel traces the notion of city as context to Jack Rowagon, who argued in the 1970s for understanding the particular histories and social and economic conditions of different cities. I agree here that tracing this urban historical anthropological approach further back in time to W.E.B. Du Bois and St. Clair Drake would have strengthened her discussion of these varying aspects of urban context. Du Bois's and Drake's classic studies of urban neighborhoods and migrants in Philadelphia and Chicago explicated the role race and racism played in the histories, socioeconomic conditions, and wider forces that impacted these urban contexts. So taking a cue from Du Bois and Drake, I attempt to fold the refinements of the approaches that I discussed earlier in the paper into this city as context framework that addresses the hegemonic racial epistemologies and ideologies shaping the experiences of international migrants. In this paper, I draw from my ethnographic research with African international students in Malaysia, and I draw some comparisons with African immigrants in China, and also in the Western Hemisphere, the U.S., in Caribbean, and South America. And I focus in this comparison on examining the dominant racial schemas, the prototypes, ideologies, and color hierarchies that African international students, as well as African immigrants in the other context, face. And secondly, I should be able to address some aspects of the meta discourse of race talk in Malaysia, especially since there's been a serious concern with anthropological activism and things that we can do. So perhaps there's some areas in there that we can draw on. First of all, in terms of Malaysian context, the two hegemonic and interconnected racial schemas are extant, one rooted in the European colonial period and the other in the post-colonial times. They constitute significant forces that structure the urban context of Kuala Lumpur and other cities across Malaysia. The white supremacy racial schema is a legacy of European expansion and domination in the region of insular Southeast Asia. A succession of colonial powers sought control of the lucrative trade running through the Straits of Malacca, beginning with the Portuguese and then by the Dutch and the British, who eventually consolidated British Malaya. Abraham, underscoring the historical context of the ideology of white supremacy in British Malaya, states, quote, "Since colonialism here involved domination by a numerically insignificant number of whites over masses of non-whites, there was always an emphasis on the superiority of the former over the latter. The British, like other Europeans in the region, labeled dark-skinned indigenous peoples as blacks, Negroes, Negritos, niggers, and viewed them as this savage antithesis of civilized whites. Whites atop the colonial political economic hierarchy exploited the labor of Indians and Malays and Chinese, but many Chinese also became middlemen, traders, tax collectors, and rival of capitalists eventually. White stereotype Indians as loyal, trustworthy, docile, and servile. Malays as witty and unreliable, unsophisticated. Chinese as industrious, even ingenious, but also cruel, immoral, and wicked, which qualified to some extent their near whiteness. White stereotype themselves as civilized, industrious, and moral. Bloom notes that social stereotypes such as these can be considered prototypical models that generalize about broad social collectivities and typical individuals of these categories. I would add here, and it's important comparatively, that these prototypical models of whites and racial others were integral to the British racial schema, reinforcing their notion of superiority. So it wasn't something that was separate. It was part of this more complex cultural framework. The second racial schema, which articulates with white supremacy in Malaysia, is the cultural model of Malay supremacy that emerged in a post-colonial context. This racial schema considers Malays as a supreme group of Bumiputra, or natives of the region, situated on top of a hierarchy of all other citizen members of the post-colonial nation state. From this framework, Malays are understood to be the Tuan Ruma, or the autochthonous host and Chinese and Indians as the Tumpang, or the guests. As guests who possess a lower rank and qualified form of cultural citizenship, they are supposed to abide by the rules of the host and embody a sense of gratitude and indebtedness. Non-Malay Bumiputra, also natives and indigenous people of the region who live in peninsular Malaysia, Sabah and Sarawak, are bestowed lower prestige as they are conventionally thought of as uncivilized, backwards, and practitioners of traditional religions or Christianity rather than Islam. The racial scheme of Malay supremacy was embodied in the federal constitution at political independence and was institutionalized in post-colonial economic and political policies and representations of the nation. I can't go into those at this point. Under the post-colonial Malay state, they do validate several hybrid categories, unlike the British colonials. And of particular interest in Kuala Lumpur urban context are the Ababas and the Yongyas. They're often also called the Straits-born Chinese, the Chittis, or the Straits-born Indians, and the Mamak. The Babas and Nyonyas and the Chetis, our categories believed to date back to the pre-colonial days of the Malay Sultanates. The Amamak appears to have emerged more recently in the early 20th century as a term used for Indian converts to Islam, and later was extended to Malay hybrids and any Indian Muslims. Since these hybrid categories are viewed favorably in the mainstream Malay society, these are part of the hegemonic constructs, they are potential resources for international immigrants as they negotiate their inclusion, which is a segment of the paper I can't fully address here. But I should mention the racial epistemologies of white supremacy and Malay supremacy exist in an uneasy relationship in contemporary Malaysia. As Malay colonials such as Pickering construed the social political order, the whiter Chinese were supposed to be the preferred and dominant racial group. However, the post-colonial order features Malays as a superordinate political group, while Chinese continue their dominance over Malays in the general society and the economic realm. This structural discontinuity and political and economic preeminence adds to the tense connections between these two hegemonic racial schemas and relations between Malays and Chinese. Over the last two decades, thousands of African international students have moved to Greater Kuala Lumpur, the capital of Malaysia, an urban context noted by the structures and tensions of these racial epistemologies. Of the Malaysian education industry seeking to become a regional hub for English language education, desired and actively sought after African student customers. My African interlocutors reported experiencing social exclusion, unfair grading, harassment from security forces, being shunned in public by many locals, difficulties with renting apartments and with employment, and some have been victims of acts of violence upon their dark-skinned African bodies. They have also been the victims of the use of racial epithets, several other more emergent terms, Wang Hitam, which is black cloud, the black lads, Hop Pei in Cantonese for blacks, Gaga Hitam, black crows, and a lot of these metaphorical meanings in these that need to be explored and examined. But I do want to move on to an area of activism, or at least an opening for activism. Despite the hegemony of white Malay supremacy racial schemas, the presence of anti-racist rhetoric and ideologies and metalinguistic discourse could weaken the deleterious effects of racism and improve the experiences of African international students. And there are several strains of anti-racist rhetoric and ideologies in Malaysian society. In fact, the Malaysian federal government has promoted a brand of top-down multiculturalism for several decades. It has stressed friendly and family-like relations between all racial groups of citizen members of the society. The rhetoric of top-down multiculturalism was accompanied with legal restrictions on public discourse about several sensitive topics following the racial riots of 1969. It became an offense to question matters relating to citizenship, the national language, the special position of Malays and other natives, the legitimate interests of other communities, and saving the sovereignty of the Malay rulers. However, as St. Clair Drake pointed out, there are often significant contradictions between widely promulgated political rhetoric and the beliefs people live by. In Malaysia, the rhetoric of harmonious multiculturalism and family life interracial relationships contradicted the ongoing racial divisions, institutionalized racism, and sociopolitical struggles over Malay special rights and political and religious dominance. Moving to another section on the Americas and the Caribbean, to bring in some comparison before I run out of time. a white supremacy racial scheme has emerged during the processes of European expansion, colonialism, and the establishment of plantation slavery in the Americas and the Caribbean. Spanish, Portuguese, French, British, and other light-skinned European peoples were conceived of as superior to indigenous peoples living across the Western Hemisphere, and dark-skinned Africans captured and forcibly transported to labor as slaves. European colonialists and slave owners created a variety of white supremacy racial schemas in the different societies that developed in the region. And that's where I go on to look at some of the varieties in South America, the Caribbean, and the U.S. And I argue overall, drawing on some other theorists like Deborah Thomas, against making too large a distinction between these varieties, I interpret that they're variations on a theme of white supremacy. European settlers also developed prototypes of themselves, contrasting racial others that were integral to these white supremacy schemas, comparable to what we've seen in Malaysia. Similar to Malayness in post-colonial Malaysia, intermediate racial categories in the Americas and Caribbean are ranked according to their presumed distance from the preferred racial essence, in this case, whiteness. In regards to the racial epistemology in Cuba, Rowland points out the racial categories and color terms or gradations within each category are perceived to be, quote, advancing from blackness towards whiteness. For instance, the categories negro adelantado and mulatto adelantado are thought to be advancing to the next racial category. So again, I look at these as variations with terminology and lexicon, but fundamentally still a variant of the white supremacy racial schema, which is still deeply embedded in the societies in the region, including in the U.S. Likewise, in the U.S., whites have assessed some Asian and Latino groups they perceive to be better than blacks as merely white or honorary whites. There's some literature on that. This pattern of racism was recently expressed in the recorded discourse of a conversation between Donald Sterling, the former owner of the Los Angeles Clippers basketball team, and his associate, V. Stiviano. In order to justify why Stiviano should not associate with black people, Sterling told her she was, quote, supposed to be a delicate white or delicate Latina girl, end of quote. The notion of whitening or blanqueamiento of non-whites is integral to hegemonic white supremacy racial schemas across the Americas and the Caribbean. Moving to a segment of the last part of the paper, because I want to keep disciplined in time. In terms of China, the Han supremacy racial scheme emerged in the context of the 20th century nationalists attempting to create an ideological basis for a modern Chinese nation state. Dr. Sun Yat-sen, in a lot of his discourse, emphasized this unifying Han race as the basic yellow race of China, to quote him. And subsequently, the nationalists and the communists largely continued this framework, according to some work by Gladney. In the hegemonic racial schema, Han Chinese are superior to the minority nationalities based on their higher level of civilization, advancement, and cultural refinement, in contrast to the U.S. and Malaysia. The blood and descent are not the primary basis of hierarchy within the Han supremacy racial schema. Mainland China was never incorporated into a racial order characterized by white supremacy. Europeans only directly colonized Macau and Hong Kong. Thus, unlike Malaysia, there is only one hegemonic racial supremacy schema in the People's Republic of China. Social stereotypes and prototypical models of Han and minority nationalities are integral to the schema of Han superiority. but not so much with the African presence. So the question then for me to examine was to look at the Africans and how these representations or prototypes of Africans relate to the Han supremacy schema. Increasing numbers of African students, professionals, and traders have been flowing into mainland China's cities over the last few decades. As of 2012, Adams Bodomo estimated that there are around 500,000 Africans in China, mostly traders residing in cosmopolitan centers such as Beijing, Shanghai, Guangzhou, and Yiwu, the world's largest commodities market. Thousands of these Africans are students studying on Chinese government's scholarships. And Azahra Abaiti, a student from Ghana, reported being treated like a spectacle, a circus and a tourist site by Chinese in public places. They would use the category of Feizu, for her, a Feizu Ren, a person of the African continent. And the first character means not be, not have, not wrong, incorrect, and lack. And so I interpret that this use of this label, again, is similar to some of the terms in Malaysia and perhaps in the Western Hemisphere in the way that they summon some of the racial epistemologies, but they're not locked in the same way in a racialized, a color, phenotypic-based sort of schema or cultural framework. So to make a couple concluding thoughts, I propose this theory of immigration, again, based on the framework I mentioned above, but the comparison of some aspects of my ethnographic research in African international students in Kuala Lumpur, Malaysia, with corresponding conditions and experiences of Africans in the Americas, Caribbean, and mainland China, attempts to make a contribution to developing this. And one of the key points, I think, is that it's important to discern the hegemonic racial epistemologies in the destination city, as the nature of these forms of cultural knowledge will have a major influence on the experience of immigrants. Locals categorize and assess immigrants based on these shared cultural schema and prototypical models. The schemas of white racial supremacy and ideas about the basis of racism vary widely across societies. As we have described in these particular cases, racial supremacy may be understood as being based in a skin color hierarchy, a level of civilization, and or autochthony and religion, as in with the Malay supremacy. So some variations. There also may be more than one racial supremacy schema with structural consequences for the lives of immigrants, which may be the case in many post-colonial contexts, as it was in Malaysia. In such cases, the articulation of one or more racial schemas may require careful analysis because they may be in a dynamic relationship and one in which one drives the cultural force of the other. In cases where the racial prototypes are integral to and or reinforce the hierarchies within the racial schemas, as for Africans and Europeans in the Americas and the Caribbean, immigrants may receive less pastoral care and harsher discipline. On the other hand, in cases where racial prototypes are primarily based on mappings of conceptions of global inequalities onto humankind, as for Africans and Europeans in China, immigrant experiences may be more varied and fluid.
Good afternoon. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, good. I want to echo Tim's thanks to Adela, Leith, Carmen, the ABA, and especially for that terrific lunch, and to all of you for coming here and staying awake after that terrific lunch. So, without further ado, I will introduce the title of my paper, African Americans and Africa, The Continuing Dialectic Revisited. The paper will examine the evolving relations between African immigrants and African Americans, particularly in New York,
which has the largest number of African immigrants in the United States, and explore to the degree to which old and new forms of race, racism, and the politics of culture shape the interaction between these groups, who have been actually viewed by power holders to be of the same race, but who consider themselves to be of very different cultures. The paper was inspired by an article written by the late Elliot Skinner titled Afro-Americans and Africa, the Continuing Dialectic. In it, Skinner traces the history of the dialectic, which has been noted by both African-American and African intellectuals, artists, and politicians. This concern with the outsider, the stranger, as the late Chinua Achebe wrote, is, quote, not peculiar or particularly unique, as many writers from Du Bois to Camus, Sartre, Baldwin, and Morrison have also struggled with this conundrum of the outsider, the other, in other ways in their own respective locales. Historically, the original captives brought from Africa all wanted to return to Africa. Those that could legally return did so, while others rebelled, sometimes taking over ships and crew. All hoped to go there when they died. Skinner speculated, however, that by the second generation, the children of these captives, whether American-born or from the West Indies, quote, grew to prefer the land to which they were born, to the now mythical land beyond the sea, unquote. Anthropologists and historians mark this generation as establishing African-American culture through music, customs, foods, language, and labor. What they wanted, slave or freeborn, were their full civil rights. One such freeborn African-American, Captain Paul Cuffee, who was born in 1759 and died in 1817, advocated mass emigration of blacks to Africa and is considered by some to be the father of black nationalism. Cuffee, whose African name Kofi means born on Friday, became the wealthiest man in his hometown of Westport, Massachusetts. He owned as many as 10 ships, manned exclusively by black crews, and he settled at least 9 black families consisting of 38 people in Sierra Leone. His entrepreneurial spirit and advocacy of a return to Africa would be echoed in the 20th century by Marcus Garvey. Cuffee ultimately supported the American Colonization Society, a white southern group whose goal was to ship manumitted blacks back to Africa. The dialectic concerning African Americans and Africans had begun. Blacks who saw no future in the United States felt that settling in Africa, Christianizing and civilizing it, would be good for both themselves and Africans. But as the future would reveal, not all Africans agreed. Other African Americans viewed these efforts as an essentially racist ploy to rid the United States of unwanted persons, despite the fact that it was these second-class citizens who had built the country and continued to do so. The early phases of the dialectic continued with Martin Delaney. He was born in 1812 and died in 1885. Delaney believed that African Americans should return to Africa, and Frederick Douglass, his ideological opponent, who had an intellectual interest in Africa, believed that the place for African Americans was in the Americas. Not necessarily the United States, but in the Americas. The African-American experience post-emancipation led many in the African-American community to focus on education and institution building. Within the U.S., they organized to protest the violence brought upon them following the end of Reconstruction. They also began to protest the emerging violence visited on their African brethren following the Berlin Conference of 1885, which solidified, formalized, and legitimized the colonization of Africa. By 1900, European states had claimed nearly 90% of the African territory. The brutality of places like the Congo Free State under King Leopold of Belgium was notorious. African Americans were among the first to denounce that brutality in the Congo. Leading the charge was Colonel George Washington Williams, an African American historian, politician, and minister who publicly leveled 12 specific charges against King Leopold. African American political involvement expanded to express their solidarity with their African brethren on the continent in other ways as well. Missionaries from the African Methodist Episcopal Church, also known as the AME Church, were held responsible for a revolt in Durban, South Africa in 1906, when black Africans tried to defend their land. At the same time, African Americans were fighting for their own rights and those of their African brethren, some on both continents. And they were at that time developing the Pan-African movement. Principal among them was, of course, W.E.B. Du Bois, who presciently stated, quote, "The problem of the 20th century is the problem of the color line," unquote. While visiting Africa in the 1920s, Du Bois wrote that his chief question was whether, quote, "Negroes are to lead in the rise of Africa, or whether they must always and everywhere follow the guidance of white folk," unquote. Du Bois remained a staunch Pan-Africanist, incurring the ire at times of some in the NAACP, you know what that is, the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, and of the most influential African-American of the time, Booker T. Washington. Washington was often solicited by colonial governments and wealthy, powerful industrialists because his policies were compromising both for African-Americans and Africans. He supported both social segregation and industrial education for African-Americans and Africans alike. In his famous speech of 1896, and that was a very big, notorious speech because it upheld social segregation, but Washington regulated both Africans and African Americans to subservient labor pools, a policy that suited both racial colonialists and capitalists. Du Bois, on the other hand, persevered to join Africans and African Americans seeking strength in a uniform struggle. As we know, he wouldn't give up the fight. He wrote, quote, "We American Negroes should know that until Africa is free, the descendants of Africa, the world over, cannot escape their chains. The NAACP, therefore, should put into the forefront of its program the freedom of Africa in work and wage, education and health, and the complete abolition of the colonial system." Du Bois continued to champion the vision of African-American and African struggles for freedom, stating that they were inseparable. He became a good friend of Kwame Nkrumah and died as an honored citizen in Ghana in 1963 at the age of 95. The independence of Ghana, Skinner wrote, ushered in yet another chapter of the continuing dialectic, whether to send an Afro-American or a white American as Ghana's first ambassador. Skinner, who had been working on an ethnographic project in Africa at the time, and he was one of the first African-Americans to do so, was asked his view by the Consul General in Accra. He, Skinner, said that, quote, "The new ambassador should be a top flight career officer." And knowing that there were no blacks in that category, he argued, or he recommended, that bright young Afro-Americans be recruited for the Foreign Service, unquote. Apparently, a similar discussion occurred in the Ghanaian Foreign Office. Nkrumah, despite his solidarity with Du Bois, broke with the tradition established by the United States in Haiti and Liberia of sending a black ambassador to those countries. Nkrumah insisted that America appoint, quote, a first-class officer, naturally a white ambassador, unquote. Now, the American Negro Leadership Conference, forgive me, began to mobilize to secure positions within the U.S. Foreign Service establishment for its members, and Presidents Eisenhower and Kennedy, thank you, began to appoint black ambassadors to African countries. Skinner argued, quote, ironically, the very success of the African Americans to improve white America's relationship with Africa led to tensions between them and the new generation of Africans. When Ghanaian diplomats arrived in the United States, on the other hand, expecting the worst kind of discrimination, and indeed finding some in the form of a Maryland restaurant worker refusing to serve orange juice to the finance minister of Ghana, the African American community stood side by side with the Ghanaian community in vigorous protest. These expressions of solidarity began to fade with the arrival of African students in the 1960s during the Kennedy administration. Articles were written by white Americans pointing out that the racism directed against African Americans in the U.S. was publicized in Africa and was sullying the image of the United States. Consequently, the Kennedy administration encouraged Africans to wear their traditional clothes and speak their own native languages, thereby distinctly separating themselves from African Americans. Africans were placed in white homes and received by white associations. They studied in white, predominantly white universities and lived in segregated white neighborhoods. In other words, Africans were welcomed where African Americans were not. Nevertheless, Africans were still targets of white racism in the United States and were even subjected to physical abuse on the part of police. The irony here, as Skinner wrote, is that, quote, a number of Africans grew to resent African Americans, the innocent victims or the innocent causes of their dilemma, unquote. Moreover, studies by white scholars argued that Africans reported that they had had trouble making friends with African Americans. Now, things began to change with the passage of the Civil Rights Act of 1964, and affirmative action was enforced by President Johnson, as you know, in 1965. For the first time, significant numbers of African American students were allowed to enter institutions of higher learning. It was a period of cultural nationalism and social activism that emphasized black pride. African American artists, scholars, and students began to once again both look to Africa with pride and to actively support African liberation movements. During the late 60s and 70s, there were still more African Americans visiting Africa than Africans migrating to the United States. The 1980s saw an influx, however, of Africans, many of them traders from West Africa into the United States. The reasons for this were complex, but scholars have noted the austere conditions brought about by the imposition of structural adjustment policies implemented by the World Bank and the International Monetary Fund. These policies and the global restructuring they brought hit African economies particularly hard, resulting in an even greater polarization between the rich and the poor. Some migrants entered legally on tourist visas. Others claimed asylum. New York City was seen by many West African traders as a land of opportunity, and for some, it still is. Dangers faced both from the mistreatment reported by some detained by immigration authorities and the deaths of the likes of Amadou Diallo and Mohamed Ba, both innocent victims of the New York City police force, proved that their fears were justified. Nevertheless, Amadou Diallo's mother, Katiadou Diallo, has pointed out that Amadou, though a peddler, was educated and came from a prosperous family. He had no reason to believe that he too would not be prosperous following the footprints of his parents. New York City, as you know, has always been polarized between the extremely wealthy and the poor. As Paul Stoller noted in his innovative ethnography of West African traders in Money Has No Smell, quote, the expansion of the gulf between rich and poor in New York City created space for the rapid growth of an informal economy. As leading scholars suggest, the worldwide growth of informal entrepreneurial activities, which are unregulated, devolved from global restructuring, unquote. Today, there is a larger African-born population in the United States than at any other time in history. It's doubled between 2000 and 2010 from 881,300 in 2000 to 1.6 million in 2010. And incredibly, these figures dwarf the roughly 450,000 African-born captives, including some 50,000 first brought to the Caribbean, who arrived during slavery. Some of these immigrants came through the diversity visa, better known as the green card lottery, which was established in 1990 to diversify the immigrant population of the United States and was, quote, designed in part to help more Irish settle here in the United States. Over the past two decades, though, the complexion of the lottery winners became noticeably darker. Today, about half of the visa winners come from Africa. The immigration bill currently making its way through the United States Senate would put an end to it. African Americans in the Congressional Black Caucus have joined African-born immigrants to oppose the bill, in this case recognizing the racism attacking both of these constituencies. Moreover, Africans are well aware of the difficulty of entering Europe, Israel, or Australia, for example. And once there, they face extreme hostility and discrimination. Even those students who have gone to Malaysia, as Tim pointed out, to study have encountered racist harassment and discrimination by a populace whose government encouraged them to study there. By contrast, the United States seems to be more welcoming. Now, I know I don't have a lot of time, but let me just give you a demographic overview. Nearly half of African immigrants are naturalized United States citizens, and 7 in 10 speak only English or speak it very well. Just under 3/4 of African immigrants are black, while only 1/5 are, quote, white. The largest number of African immigrants are found in California, New York, Texas, Maryland, and Virginia. The top countries of origin for African immigrants are Nigeria, Ethiopia, Egypt, Ghana, and Kenya. 2/5 of these African immigrants have at least a bachelor's degree, and more than 1/3 work in professional jobs. I told you that the number of African immigrants has increased drastically, especially among male immigrants, but it is almost doubled among female immigrants as well. So they are now about 4% of the foreign-born population. Overall, educationally, they outproduce the overall United States population. About 16.1% of them have graduate degrees compared to 10.4% of American-born peoples. About 24.2% of them have bachelor's degrees compared to 17.7% of native-born Americans. And the overwhelming majority of them are in management, business, and science. That's about 37.7% of them. Now, many of these more recent African-born immigrants have settled in their own communities or established themselves in older black or Latino communities and maintain close contact with their countrymen, as most immigrants generally do. And this is particularly true in New York, where you can find cab drivers going to the same restaurants or people going to the same mosques, etc. In the interest of time, I won't give you examples of the Africans that are currently in New York running for public office or who have established themselves in their local communities as leaders. I wanted to move ahead a little bit here to discussing some of the tensions, though, that still occur between our communities, our respective communities. The overall demographics of today's African immigrants have changed once again. I said that they were professionals with advanced degrees, but they often find themselves competing with African Americans. Others have come in greater numbers to study in institutions of higher education, and studies have shown that there are dialectical tensions between Africans and African Americans, expressed in things like the fact that more Africans are accepted in American universities of higher education, especially prestigious ones, than African Americans are. And Lanny Guinier and Henry Gates have documented this in articles, as have others. Yet another dialectical tension is the whole notion of the outsider or the intruder, as Skinner would have noted. And that stereotype is evidenced in comments from African Americans, such as, quote, "I'm tired of the stereotype that Black Americans don't want to work." An African American, this is a quote from an African American. "I've worked my whole life very hard, but I got laid off and I've got mouths to feed. I need a job. What I don't understand is why our leaders are going to admit another million immigrant workers next year to take jobs when 3 million Black Americans can't find work. Do our leaders really believe that Black Americans don't want to work? Let's slow down mass immigration and save jobs for Americans, all Americans." Now that ad was actually financed by an anti-immigration group. We shouldn't be surprised, Numbers USA. I want to just conclude by saying, although these tensions have arisen, there are two very important areas where we can still see close collaboration between African Americans and Africans. And those are, of course, the divestment anti-apartheid movement of the 1980s and 90s, and the 2001 Durban conference, which brought together many grassroots groups to work on reparations. So that should give us some hope. In conclusion, African Americans and Africans still have an uneasy but unbreakable bond. Both communities are still subjected to discrimination based on skin color, but their histories and experiences are significantly different. We've seen that they've come together. We hope that they continue to do so. And this paper laid that historical foundation. My colleagues and I hope to continue this work by looking at this collaboration or this dialectic in politics, religion, and the arts. Thank you.
Thank you, Michelle. Agora nós vamos passar para o João Pacheco de Oliveira, do Museu Nacional, da UFRJ, que o título da sua apresentação é Pacificação, Retórica Racista no Brasil Contemporâneo.
Boa tarde. Quando eu recebi o convite da professora Bela para participar desse grupo de reflexão sobre raça e racismo e deslocamento, eu tive uma dúvida inicial em relação à minha inserção, tá? Porque eu sempre trabalho com povos indígenas, a minha linha de trabalho, e na verdade no Brasil os povos indígenas não são considerados como portadores de raça, tá? Em geral não se atribui a eles qualquer condição racial. O problema é um problema de cultura, é um problema de civilização e não de raça. Eu acho que, no entanto, embora a categoria não seja aplicada, existem mecanismos extremamente duros de exclusão e manifestações de tolerância em relação aos indígenas que me aproximariam muito e achariam, me conduzem crer que a categoria de racismo seria bastante oportuna de ser aplicada tratar eles. Então eu faço uma diferença entre a ideia da raça propriamente e do racismo. É, uma vez num trabalho localizado, desenvolvido com a população do Amazonas, eu cheguei a ver um caso de extrema violência contra os indígenas resultar em mortes truculentas, crianças, pessoas feridas, e aparentemente a insensibilidade da sociedade era enorme, extraordinária. Ninguém via algum caso de infração de leis ocorrer. E isso me levou a pensar realmente quanto, né, existe uma linguagem construída, um idioma da violência, que se manifesta não em todos os momentos, mas se manifesta em alguns momentos das relações sociais e que é capaz de levar à prática de atos impensáveis em outros contextos. Mas que, no entanto, são reconhecidos muitas vezes pelos cidadãos e até pelos bons cidadãos como legítimos dentro daquelas ocasiões. Na realidade, o ponto de partida empírico para a minha reflexão foi um fato extraordinariamente estranho, ocorrido não na Amazônia, mas na cidade do Rio de Janeiro. Em função de acontecimentos existentes no final do ano de 2008, as tropas militares, com apoio de, inclusive, a polícia e também do Exército Nacional, eles ocuparam, em caráter experimental, uma das grandes favelas do Rio de Janeiro. E transformaram essa ocupação de algo temporário em algo permanente, que depois denominaram, explicaram, né, a população como uma criação de uma unidade policial pacificadora. E é mencionado sempre sobre a sigla UPP, que é muito conhecida nesse sentido. E o que me causou bastante estranheza em relação ao assunto era que havia uma verdadeira comoção, um estado de euforia incompreensível entre a população autônoma. Na realidade, a ocupação dos morros cariocas foi saudada como uma conquista imperial, ou talvez uma conquista até futebolística, a Copa do Mundo, por exemplo, mas uma coisa admirável que emocionava as pessoas e que não havia nenhuma possibilidade de alguém questionar o acerto daquela política. Contrastava de modo claro com os estudos realizados pelos especialistas de antropologia urbana e sociólogos e também ativistas de direitos humanos, que geralmente identificavam a política realizada pelo governo nos últimos anos como muito ruim e alguns até uma política genocida. Né? Então havia isso caminhava, na realidade, na direção inversa das análises científicas estabelecidas e divulgadas. Era também, do ponto de vista da população, da classe média, sobretudo, que lia jornais e meios de comunicação, era uma coisa considerada bastante dirigida apenas ao combate da criminalidade. E era como se fosse uma ação puramente purificadora de maus elementos dentro da sociedade. Os dados estatísticos não autorizam qualquer reflexão nessa direção. Né? As favelas cariocas representam praticamente 1,5 milhão de pessoas, 20%, 22% da população do município, e não poderia jamais ser pensado como apenas composta por marginais ou pessoas à margem da lei. O que me tornou especialmente interessado nisso para desenvolver uma etnografia, mais uma etnografia a partir de fontes lidas do que propriamente de trabalho de campo, mas dentro de um espírito de fazer etnografia, foi a aplicação da categoria pacificação. É uma categoria muito marcada para os antropólogos, em especial para mim, para a minha linha de pesquisa. pesquisa no Museu Nacional e sempre vimos dentro dessa ação do Estado um mecanismo de apropriação dos territórios indígenas e, no período colonial, de utilização da população indígena como força de trabalho. Tudo isso realizado com extrema violência e, enfim. Eu acho que eu não vou me reportar muito a recuperar a categoria de pacificação. Eu fiz isso dentro de um artigo, né? Na realidade, a minha comunicação ao Congresso teve alguma dinâmica paralela. Né? E depois de ter feito as 10 páginas disciplinadamente que Bela me pediu para apresentar em Chicago, eu acabei pensando um pouco no final do ano, escrevi um artigo de 40 páginas para a revista Manda do Museu Nacional. Conversei com algumas pessoas e, a pedido deles, realmente resolvi escrever as ideias que estava tendo. E, nesse momento, o artigo está, inclusive, publicado, é acessível. Eu vou tentar resumir um pouco as conclusões, tentando abstrair um pouco esse lado de comparação com a situação indígena e trabalhando mais com a situação urbana, né? Apresentando mais os dados da situação urbana. Eu imagino que os estudiosos da Austrália, Estados Unidos e outros países sejam mais contrastantes, talvez. Acredito que no caso da centração colonial de domínio, de implantação e conquista dentro de territórios nativos, de territórios indígenas, é uma ação muito violenta, né? Então há muito a reportar em relação a isso. É mais extraordinário pensar numa situação contemporânea sobre instituições democráticas e, segundo liberdade de imprensa, segundo uma suposta aplicação de modelos modernos de gestão da vida e de reconhecimento, pelo menos para uma parte da população, das noções de cidadania. Ao tocar na questão da cidadania, o que eu queria sugerir é que o modelo brasileiro de lidar com a sua população não permite que a cidadania seja pensada como algo generalizado. Só existe cidadania para certos setores. A cidadania é apenas pensada como a marcação de privilégios para determinadas pessoas e absoluta exclusão para as demais. E eu acho que esse exercício, à medida que eu ia lendo e conversando com especialistas da área, foi se configurando como uma coisa absolutamente evidente. As favelas surgiram na história do Rio de Janeiro por volta do ano de 1890. Tá? E, basicamente, essa população vem de conflitos rurais, como a Guerra de Canudos, uma guerra importante, que criou a população japonesa. E eu acho que, em termos das origens do Brasil, de classe, ela vem de uma população camponesa, muitas vezes mestiçada, indígena e camponesa, que foi expelida e saiu das reservas das missões religiosas do passado, do período colonial. E aí se somou uma enorme parte dos escravos africanos libertados em 1888 por uma lei do Império, que foram apenas libertados, mas deixados absolutamente sem qualquer apoio. Essa massa, em algumas vezes excluída até das fazendas onde eles viviam, eram explorados, mas pelo menos conseguiram viver, essa massa se deslocou em parte para as cidades. E o Rio, como capital, foi um dos lugares que mais sofreu um direcionamento. Eu não vou dar dados, porque eu vou dar dados históricos sobre isso, mas, enfim, é uma coisa que se inicia com números pequenos, porque mesmo a ocupação de morros é permitida, porque são ex-soldados que lutaram em Canudos e suas famílias, então é uma regalia, um privilégio dado a alguns descendentes de soldados, e isso começa a se estender de modo incrível. O primeiro censo feito nas favelas cariocas ocorre em 1947, e nesse momento já há uma indicação de 14% da população vive dentro de favelas. brasileiro que trabalha com os dados estatísticos está sempre crescendo. Né? Ele não cresce exponencialmente, mas ele cresce sempre. Né? Essa, se expande de um modo constante. É, acho que durante um... Dentro da temática do seminário, um assunto importante são os deslocamentos. Né? As políticas governamentais em relação às favelas sempre implicaram os deslocamentos. Né? Sobretudo durante o período da ditadura militar, foram realizados extensos deslocamentos de grandes favelas do Rio de Janeiro. Sempre coisas extremamente violentas, em geral com incêndios, incêndios criminosos dessas áreas, e outras vezes com o uso das forças da polícia militar para a remoção. A argumentação sempre era gerar moradias populares em outro setor da cidade. Nada disso pode ser comprovado como resultado real. Essas áreas foram deslocadas para a periferia da cidade, se favelizaram, se empobreceram extremamente e são hoje identificadas como favelas, talvez até das mais violentas. Em outro momento da história das relações da cidade com as favelas, surgiu uma nova figura, a figura da favela como lugar do crime, lugar do crime organizado, sobretudo. Né? E a partir disso, sobretudo nos anos, a partir de 1990, se desenrolou uma verdadeira guerra contra o crime dentro da favela. Isso, operações policiais eram realizadas como se estivessem dentro do território de guerra. A faixa de Gaza não teria nenhuma diferença, não tem nenhuma diferença em relação a uma favela do Rio de Janeiro. As ocupações são extraordinariamente violentas, eu não vou ter tempo para reportar isso, mas posso dar alguns números. Em 1998, eram computados como mortos pela polícia militar, 20 pessoas por mês dentro das favelas. Em 2007, esse número passa para 1.300. São dados de uma guerra. Né? São todos mortos pela polícia militar. Eu acho que é importante, eu volto ao tema do racismo, tentar identificar os procedimentos policiais e na insensibilidade da mídia, que também estimula esse tipo de coisa, a existência de um racismo institucionalizado bastante duro dentro da sociedade brasileira, da sociedade carioca especial. Né? Quer dizer, um primeiro componente disso seria bastante antigo, conhecido, os brasileiros todos sabem, que, favelas, casas em favelas não são casas. Elas não têm qualquer proteção. Elas podem ser invadidas pela polícia, porque elas são espaços públicos, não necessitam mandato judicial, e elas podem ser destruídas dentro de uma revista feita pela polícia. Os cidadãos também, eles raramente são, até nas notas policiais, nos relatórios policiais, nunca são descritos como cidadãos. Eles são sempre descritos como suspeitos. Ou então, o termo na linguagem policial que corresponde são os elementos. O elemento é um virtual criminoso, já vai compor a cena do crime. Né? Eu acho que na cidade existe uma coisa que o geógrafo anotou com bastante felicidade, com uma cultura do pavor. Né? Foi implantado pela imprensa e realmente é estimulado também pelas próprias autoridades governamentais, qualquer escala. Essa é uma iniciativa que faz com que qualquer pessoa da classe média se afaste de uma criança de 7 anos de idade que possa estar descalça. Se for negra, então, pior ainda, mas não precisa ser negra, pode ser simplesmente uma pessoa pobre. Né? Ela já é virtualmente um agente de algum crime pavoroso. Essa cultura do pavor, ela repercute dentro das próprias forças policiais. É importante pensar. Os policiais andam dentro das favelas como se estivessem realmente em território inimigo. E é assim que é descrito para eles pelo estudo extremo, né, militarmente, e pelos seus superiores. Estão em território inimigo. Acho que um elemento importante também desse racismo é a gentrificação. Né? Cada dia se torna mais difícil a circulação de pessoas da favela dentro das áreas da cidade. Especialmente os jovens são sempre objeto de revistas feitas pelas forças policiais de um modo extremamente violento, arbitrário, aviltante. De maneira que eles tendam a ficar simplesmente dentro das favelas. A estratégia é de compressão. Né? O risco de sair é muito grande. Né? Quem acompanha a vida da cidade, até a ida de um jovem a uma praia do Rio de Janeiro, pode implicar coisas terríveis. Porque há sempre a ideia de que existe acionado um mecanismo chamado arrastão, quer dizer, uma ação feita por jovens que leva a roubar toda a população. Enfim, eu acho que um outro ponto importante, muito importante, é a questão da naturalização das mortes. Né? Há um instrumento administrativo chamado auto de resistência. Ele é um formulário policial que justifica a execução de qualquer pessoa. Supostamente ela resistiu à ação policial e por isso foi morta. Né? Os dados são impressionantes em relação a isso. Né? No ano de 2007 mesmo, mais de 1.300 pessoas foram mortas dessa maneira. Quer dizer, 18% dos casos de homicídio no Rio de Janeiro são feitos pela própria polícia através de autos de resistência. Comparando a relação entre o número de prisões, e o número de mortes, no Rio a relação é de um preso, 23 prisões para cada morte. Né? Segundo especialistas, nos Estados Unidos, ela é de 1 para 37 mil. Eu acho que observar esse material todo deve voltar a refletir sobre a questão da raça. A população que mora nas favelas, ela não é, segundo as estatísticas, predominantemente negra. Ela reflete um pouco a composição da população brasileira. Mas, de certo modo, existem mais negros na favela do que em outro lugar. Né? Mas o que eu queria terminar, de certo modo, sugerindo como uma reflexão importante, é que o elemento racial faz parte, sim, de todo esse processo de violência à vida. Mas existe uma outra coisa. Eu acho que, nesse sentido, o termo de pacificação, ele pode ter me dado uma pista importante para descobrir estruturas que, desde o Brasil colonial, estão atuando, né, contra os desfavorecidos no país. A questão da civilização. Nós continuamos a ter o mesmo problema que há em relação aos indígenas. Né? Eles são, um tratamento dado a eles, para quem trabalhou historicamente com esse material, os temores que eles suscitam são os mesmos que os índios bravos da época colonial ou da época do século XIX tinham. Eles são simplesmente objeto de pavor da população. Então, qualquer ação é justificada e qualquer meio utilizado para isolá-los, matá-los, encarcerá-los ou isolá-los, já é uma coisa suficiente. Entre essas coisas, esses identificadores, a gente pode dizer a escolaridade baixa, né? A falta de empregos ou desemprego, a renda baixa, mas muitos elementos são puramente comportamentais. É o modo de vestir, é o modo de usar um boné, muitas vezes a relação, a parte da manhã falou, a relação com o rap, né? Com músicas modernas, com questionamentos que possam ser feitos ao modo de conduta do branco, são elementos suficientes para revistas e mortes de grande parte das pessoas. Existe entre esses os bailes funk, por exemplo, são pesquisados, foram refletidos, tem análise, a própria fenômeno das galeras também foi intensamente estudado. Enfim, o que eu queria era, terminando, dizer que eu acho que a categoria de pacificação é uma categoria crucial para entender o Brasil que compõe, de um modo bastante complexo, essa imagem patriarcal né, e favorável da ação da dominação como uma violência brutal, extraordinária. É, eu acho que esse jogo bastante completo pode ser resolvido por essa ideologia, né, de pacificar. Você tem sempre que produzir um outro que é em si desprovido, não só de direitos, mas até de humanidade. Né? Ele é simplesmente aquele a ser executado. Né? Como um antigo texto da literatura brasileira, há um poema famoso dizendo que os indígenas, aquele que deve morrer. Né? Ele é aquele que deve morrer. Certo? Obrigado.
I also want to thank Bella, Carmen, Liz, also Pamela Kaya, who I've collaborated with on the paper that I'm going to present today, who was not able to be with us, but was part of the organizing effort. This is a paper that emerges from a network that's very much in formation and that's producing a research agenda which in many ways is yet to be realized. The network is called VIA, and it stands for something words in Spanish, the Red de Acción Investigación Antirracista. And it's a network of organizations that work in six different countries in response to various practices, policies, expressions of racism. And its goals, the goals of each of the organizations that conform the network are combined activism, formation of leaders, and formation of participants in efforts and research. Actually, Leith Mullins is a very active member and a senior advisor of this network. And one of the key elements, which actually builds very nicely on João Pacheco's analysis, is the importance of black of placing the experiences of racism and of anti-racist strategies in comparative black indigenous perspective. The argument being that actually in maybe I'll say more in US academic frameworks, often the two are kept quite separate or are not in sufficient dialogue. And the argument is particularly when you're trying to develop research that has practical contributions, that, and also for analytical reasons, bringing black indigenous experiences together can be extremely illuminating and rich. The research element of this network has yet to begin, but one of the key products, really, so far of the work has been a series of workshops, of exchanges, of dialogues among these organizations in very different settings, has been to produce a research project, a topic, a problem. And that problem is alluded to in the title of this paper, the prospect that we're coming to the end of a two-decade, three-decade process of expansion of rights-based and cultural difference that often goes by the name of multiculturalism, which of course has been articulated with the expansion of economic reforms of neoliberalism. I want to give just three brief examples of of the kind of discussion that emerged from these workshops that helped us to help this topic to congeal. Actually, the first one is dramatically represented by João Pacheco's paper. The Afro-Brazilian organization that, and all of these happened at the same time in a workshop in Colombia, and it kind of brought the debate to fruition. This immense contradiction between the expansion of affirmative action of quotas in Brazil, promoted by the state, at the same time that the level of anti-black violence and criminalization is also on the rise. How can we appeal to a state for rights that's also committing massive daily violations of our very existence? And in Colombia, the Afro-Colombian example was even more specific in a sense, and had to do with the fact that Afro-Colombians have benefited immensely from the multicultural turn in territorial in gaining territorial rights dramatically. But many of those territories are now in they're unable to be even accessed. Afro-Colombians are the largest internal refugee population in Latin America, and there's a legal realization that actually was just being analyzed when we were there a year ago March, that when Afro-Colombians leave their territories, they leave most of the rights that multiculturalism confers behind. Very hard to appeal to the rights when you're a displaced Afro-Colombian in Bogota as opposed to living in territory in Chocó. This idea that state violence and parastate violence would produce a situation where the very rights that you gain would then be impossible to exercise because you've been displaced from your territory really congealed the contradiction. And then the third example came from Guatemala, where the rise of extractivism, particularly around mining, has produced and hydroelectric dams. It's the story that we know very well in many parts of Latin America. The level of criminalization of protest against mega projects, against extractivist projects, had gotten to the point where the very significant multicultural turn in Guatemala and the rise of the notion of Maya rights and the possibilities of Mayas becoming full citizens was being contradicted daily by the fact that civic protest against the development model was being criminalized. So all these very, very kind of puntual political observations was leading to a broader debate about the possibility, not at the end of multiculturalism, but the idea that this two-decade expansion of multicultural rights is really coming to an end. And I think the paper, some of the papers this morning very much spoke to that. The idea that aggressive extractivism, that criminalization, that internal divisions within the group that has been conferred rights, which is very much a product of multicultural policies, is also undermining efficacy. And finally, a kind of an overflow effect, the fact that the multicultural turn provided actually a tremendous amount of opportunities amid the contradictions, and that in some cases, simply, those opportunities have become very dangerous for states, and states are actually backing off of previous commitments. So a sense of neoliberal multiculturalism as an expansive state project of governance with all its contradictions, the idea is it coming to an end? Is that project of governance coming to an end? If so, what follows? And particularly, what follows for anti-racist strategies, which have been very much conceived around the notion of mobilizing for rights. Mobilizing for rights conferred by the state. And actually has in Brazil and many other places created a very clear role for anthropologists that accompany those mobilizations for rights and often are the justificatory produced the justificatory discourse. So if we're coming to an end of that era, what comes next? So that's the research problem, and we're just starting, and so what we want to do is figure out how that broader problem is working out in various different places and what kinds of strategies are emerging, and to do the comparative analysis that Lee spoke about earlier. So what this paper is about is, first of all, laying out that much in a little more detail, a little more rigor, and then turning to a response and a possible answer to that question that's emerged to some extent in political terrain and very much kind of in theoretical academic discourse. And that's this notion of colonialidad del poder, which I'm taking as being very closely related to an argument which might be summarized as the argument for alternative ontologies. And essentially, what colonialidad del poder does is, and actually Elena summarized it very well. I won't go into any detail. It's about rethinking kind of the character of the colonial process, centering race and racism in those analyses, and bringing the idea of colonial relations up through to the present as a way of understanding how states function now, how institutionalized racism persists. And also, and this is where otros ontologías, otros come in, it brings with it a sort of a notion of a very pointed critique of modernity, the modern project as a colonial project, and opens the idea, the horizon of an alternative political project that's grounded in other ways of composing social relations, a radically different way of that humans and the natural world relate to one another, and the whole idea that modernity is constituted around kind of a inherent forms of inequality that need to be questioned and overcome by introducing the idea of other ontologies as a basis for politics. So, I want to make sure I don't go over here. So you'll tell me when I have five, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So what the paper is really about is trying to, and this idea, and I should say it's particularly associated with a group of theorists, all of whom are Latin American born, but are in the United States: Marisol La Cadena, Arturo Escobar, Mario Blaser, and I think also very much associated with Boaventura de Sosa Santos, among many others. And what this is trying to do, this paper, is to take very seriously that proposal, and as part of taking it seriously, subject it to a kind of critique, which I think sometimes has people been reluctant to do because so much of it is a sort of an aspirational as opposed to an analytical position. And critiquing the aspirations, particularly when there's such a sense of crisis, of kind of civilizational malaise, and in the lack of kind of clear political visions, political horizons, seems an awfully kind of petty and small-minded or counterproductive thing to do. And the argument is, no, we have to, in order to take seriously the political potential of these ideas, we have to subject them to more thoroughgoing critique. And so the paper is also kind of a reflection on the relationship between the theories we use and the kind of political possibilities those theories generate. So very quickly, actually, some questions that Bella raised about the previous version set me back to do some more reading, and I decided that this really had to start with a gentle critique of the very organization that's sponsoring this meeting, the World Anthropology Network, because these theorists start very much in that space, and then I think move on, and the moving on I think is an important key to the whole picture.
And so I did a lot more reading on World Anthropology Network, and just to be very respectfully provocative, I think the problem, there's a lot of very solitary and kind of crucial contributions of World Anthropology Network. I think there's a sense in which, and actually Ruben's commentary the first day in the panel in AAA, in ABBA, pointed to this, some of these points. I think there's a sense in which World Anthropology Network has not theorized a global political economy in a thoroughgoing way. And so what it ends up being, that the call for heteroglossia and the call for diversity of anthropological approaches ends up being, in a sense, an affirmation of national anthropological traditions, all of which have their own kind of internal contradictions and problems. And there's a sense in which we need the World Anthropology Network to theorize exactly topics like racism as part of its project, if it's going to be a project more than simply grouping together people from all over the world. It's more complex than that, but that's basically the summary. So that brings us to colonialidad. I think colonialidad really does have a political economy, a racial political economy analysis that's been very productive and very, very challenging. I think the problem with colonialidad has been that it's not been sufficiently anchored in kind of local struggles, in sort of the analysis of political subjectivities and political processes that animate the broader structures, or they're in dialectical relation with them. There's a sense in which it's a return to a kind of a structuralism that, in some ways, political economy analysis needed to get beyond. And I think there's also a more specific debate around the notion of racialization that colonialidad poder has, which we could talk about in the discussion. Some confusion or some ambiguity that need to be clarified. So I think one of the reasons that alternative ontologies as a frame has become so important is precisely because it brings the question of political subjectivities of the actors to the fore. And this is an argument around the need for a radical rupture in politics. A rupture very much associated with the critique of modernity, the idea that other ways of organizing our world is possible, and very much rooted in a valorization and a sort of a deep analysis of indigeneity, of indigenous cultural politics as the basis for alternative ontological projects. That's a terribly reductionist summary, but it'll have to do. So what I tried to do is say, okay, if we're going to take this seriously, what needs to happen where does that argument need to go? And I came up with three points. The first has to do with the notion that actually the theorists themselves use, and I've tried to problematize it, of partial connections, which is borrowed from Marilyn Strathern, and they use as a way to kind of acknowledge the fact which is a pretty commonsensical kind of observation, that alternative ontologies exist in a complex field of power relations and of constant interaction and imbrication with the dominant. And so what kind of theoretical tools do we use, what analytics do we use to understand those relationships? My sense is that the answer to that question is very, very underdeveloped in the alternative ontology argument, precisely because there's so much emphasis on the kind of the valorization of alterity. And what we need is a much more rigorous kind of notion of how you can both critique modernity and use the analytical tools that modernity has brought in some kind of combination. Otherwise, the notion of partial connections the partial connections that are inevitably part of political mobilization can only be analyzed from the analytical position of the alternative ontology, which I think is probably not either all that constructive or even possible. Secondly, and this is where this sounds very abstract, but it actually does get back to the Black indigenous anti-racism politics that I began with. There's a sense in which the alternative ontology argument is deeply grounded in indigeneity, and I think has a very problematic relationship to various kind of facets of African diaspora cultural politics. In fact, there's kind of an implicit argument that if you're going to live in the world of alternative ontologies, your cultural practices better look awfully indigenous, or else they're actually too contaminated by modernity to really have kind of political viability. And that actually relates even to the argument around anti-racism, which is where I really started engaging with this whole literature. And I'll give you one idea through a quotation. This is from Marisol de la Cadena in a 2010 article. I would like to suggest that denouncing racism, even undoing it, may address the inferiority in question, but does not address the epistemic roots of the antagonism between those entitled to rule and those destined to be ruled. What needs to be addressed is the epistemic maneuver that organized the political deciding what could be brought into politics and what belonged to a different managerial sphere. So the idea is that anti-racism is a form of politics that's inevitably limited by its location within the modern. And it seems to me that's a position that is, well, it's problematic in general. It's particularly problematic around the efforts to create Black indigenous alliances in anti-racist struggle. And the third proviso has to do with pesquisa engachada, which is kind of the idea that particularly in this kind of topic, there needs to be sustained methodological reflection on the relationship between research and political engagement. And paradoxically, the alternative ontology position, because it's been so devoted to kind of plumbing the depths of the alternative ontology, has actually been relatively silent on the positioning of the theorist, of the researcher, and of the way in which, if we were to accept an alternative ontology position, how that would change the way we do research. Presumably, in some kind of radically alternative proposal for activist research. And instead, what we get is a kind of a research that looks actually uncomfortably like traditional anthropology. And so it seems to me that the questão de pesquisa engajada needs to be placed at the center of this debate of alternative ontology. So, in conclusion, one of the striking observations, and actually Galbashenko made a reference to it, which I think would be interesting to discuss in our discussion period, where even the notion of race, not so much racism, but certainly kind of the analytics of race and racialization, work very differently in indigenous and Black political cultures. And we found that actually in various projects, activist research projects that involve Black and indigenous peoples. And one of the things that I've observed is that as you get more into the ontologies debate, those tensions actually deepen. And one of the things that's been very interesting and refreshing has been to see how anti-racism, and this may also relate to what Cheryl was saying about Africans and African Americans in certain sense, anti-racism provides a very sound common language and kind of political horizon for common work that gets interrupted and undermined when ontologies come to the fore. And I'm not sure what to make of that observation, but I think there's something there that's important to think more about and to conclude. And so finally, I want to just reiterate that I think one of the most important aspects of the alternative ontologies argument is is its aspirational force, particularly, and I found this a lot in my own graduate seminars, particularly among younger theorists and activist scholars who are looking for ways to both do rigorous research and rethink the political. And I think that aspect is to be vigorously affirmed to the point where we should expect that the existing analytical tools that come from people of my generation are going to be critiqued and superado. But at the same time, there needs to be some kind of space, particularly around this notion of partial connections, for a sort of a somewhat more amphibious approach to theory and politics, really, in thinking about the way in which whatever one's critique of modernity might be, there's a kind of an imprecation or a sort of a need to alternate between the aspirational and the contradictory here and now that requires a little less of a sort of a wholesale positioning of oneself in the alternative ontology framework. And finally, this idea that I think probably more now than ever, sort of a research agenda that's grounded in some kind of notion of pesquisa engañada is absolutely central for, not just for kind of for ethical reasons, but also because that's where I think the most interesting theoretical interventions are going to come from in the future. Thank you.
Begin by thanking all the presenters for wide-ranging and thought-provoking papers. One of the exciting things about being a discussant is that you never know what your very creative colleagues are actually going to say. So your discussion may or may not be related to what they actually say. But what I'm going to try to do is to the papers address a variety of topics and subjects. So I'm going to try to organize the discussion by placing the papers in conversation with some of the central questions in the study of comparative race and racism. First, it's important to emphasize that the papers in this conference address not race, but the social production of race, various forms of racialization. As a reminder of the importance of insisting on this distinction, Charlie's paper recounts an incident of a Mayan participant in a meeting who objects to efforts by African-descended participants to create what they call a common racial framework. Charlie quotes him as saying, "Race is what we are trying to get away from. Raza is for animals." It's essential that in our teaching, in our scholarship, in our activist work, we emphasize not race, but racialization. The social, economic, and political processes that purposefully transform various populations into races. It's important to get away from the use of race as a noun, but rather employ racialization as a verb to eschew the passive exonerative voice, which avoids responsibility. Racialization involves a relationship whereby some profit, others are dispossessed. It incorporates practices, structures, beliefs, and representations that transform certain forms of perceived differences into inequality, working through many forms of dispossession, including subordination, stigmatization, exploitation, physical violence, and sometimes genocide, all of which we've heard about in these papers. And racialization makes what is social appear natural. So as we consider the wealth of information in the papers and are presented with the many conditions under which racialization occurs, Fredrickson's formulation, which is underscored in each of these papers, comes to mind. He notes, quote, "The story of racism in the 20th century is one story with several subplots, rather than merely a collection of tales that share a common theme." And to me, this is a rather elegant way of pointing out that racism is both global and local, that the form it takes at any given time incorporates some universals, but also is historically and spatially contingent. While modern racism is significantly influenced by the circulation of Western practices and images, it is also built on old racial schema, divisions, and fault lines from the past. And Tim's discussion of racism in Malaysia and China, I think, demonstrates his points very well. And as he suggests, issues of difference in China are, of course, very complex, but I would like at some point to hear more about that and how some of those relationships are also related to China's current role in Africa and how racialization changes with respect to current circumstances, etc. But the major point here that is well demonstrated is that of, to paraphrase a well-known analysis, race is made, but under circumstances transmitted from the past. So race is made, but under circumstances transmitted from the past. Racialization frequently accompanies colonialism, nation building, and migration. Zhao provides a discussion of the processes of racialization in the colonial and republican eras and reminds us of the important differences in the ways that the colonialists interacted with indigenous and African descended people, that the category of pacification, a fundamental one initially used exclusively for indigenous people, did not depend on a doctrine of racism, though the practices of discrimination and subordination, exploitation, and violence were prevalent. Migration and displacement clearly have racialized consequences. The papers by Mawaria and Daniels demonstrate that different forms of migration, voluntary and involuntary, migrations that result from trade, commodity production, labor needs, all result in racialization, but that the variety of conditions in which migration and racialization occur may lead to very different outcomes for populations. And this is demonstrated in Zhao's discussion of Brazil, in the cases of Malaysia and China, as well as by Cheryl's contextualization of the involuntary, transported, enslaved in the trans-African trade, the formerly enslaved, who returned to Africa, the more recent African migration to the United States of African Democrats and students, followed by professionals and traders, and the complex relationships that ensue. In describing the different experiences of African students in various parts of the world, Tim asks us to consider a more local level of analysis, the importance of cities as context. Again, underscoring that experience of racism may vary widely and are contingent on location, historical, and geographic space. This leads to the ways in which the constructions of race and the processes of racialization are not only historically contingent and shaped by many interrelated processes, but though they may appear to be fixed, they are mutable. they are transformed as they are reinforced and reproduced on one hand and confronted and contested on the other. Scholars have commented on racism's mutating, chameleon-like character as it intersects with the logic of global capitalism in a particular era. In this case, a form of capitalism that is characterized by competing and contradictory tendencies. As Richardson puts it, a global capitalism that draws no color line because it seeks customers and collaborators from every race. But we also experience a particular form of capitalism that segments and divides. It intensifies race making, particularly as people cross borders in search of jobs, increasing divisions by class, education, etc. Cheryl's statistics on the class status of the new African immigrants, which she really didn't get to go into very much, and Charlie's discussion of the expanding Afro-Indigenous middle classes give us some insight into this process and the complexity. The objects of racialization are continually changing, and new forms of racialization may be based on phenotype, nationality, or religion. Old racial regimes are discarded when they are no longer useful, and new ones arise in their place. We're familiar with the demise of the old racial states, such as South Africa and the US, but also with the rise of so-called post-racialism or colorblindness, based on the claims that with the success of the civil rights movements and anti-apartheid movement, we now live in a colorblind society where each individual is free to determine his or her destiny without the need for anti-discrimination measures. This new racial ideology is integrally tied to the hegemonic project of neoliberalism, which is about unrestricted markets, flexible labor, productivity as the measure of individual worth, and perhaps more important, an ideological emphasis on individual choice. However, Charlie suggests that even these relatively new forms of racial management may have run their course. He predicts the twilight of neoliberal multiculturalism in Latin America, and that the era of expansion of rights may have come to an end, suggesting the necessity to develop new strategies. Similarly revealing Zhao's description of the appropriation of the term pacification, currently in reference to the favelas in contemporary Rio de Janeiro, reinforcing the underlying analogy between the, quote, savage Indian and young favela resident as objects of fear and resulting in a level of repression and brutality that even made the front page of the New York Times a couple of weeks ago. As scholars, we are confronted with the problem of how to analyze these transformations and their meaning for the people and the movements we work with. What are the challenges to anti-racist struggles? We have many common conditions that we face. The papers point to tensions within the receiving societies, the criminalization of protest, the privatization of prisons, the incredible rates of incarceration, state violence, and executions across the hemisphere. And the similarities between Brazil and the United States are really very interesting and very revealing in that respect. Most critical, perhaps, are the fault lines within and among groups that should be in alliance. Cheryl discusses the tensions and ambivalences between Africans and African Americans. Charlie alludes to both the tensions created by the rising Afro-Indigenous middle class and their potential class loyalties, as well as what seems to be perceived as contradictions between the ontological outlook of indigeneity and Afro-descendants. And here I'd like to raise some questions for discussion, and I hope there'll be discussion on this. I wonder if the notion of ontologies is really too static, too inflexible to be useful, particularly in the context of activist anthropology. Like Charlie, I have some questions about the tendency to portray what often comes off as a relatively homogeneous and radically different indigenous ontological framework compared to multiple Afro-descendant frameworks that are entangled with modernism. I agree that all current ontologies are intertwined with modernity, that the Gramscian multiple articulations, the articulation described by the French structural Marxists, and the partial connections, sometimes used in a way similar to Du Bois's double consciousness, that Marisol de Cardena borrows from Marilyn Strathern in order to speak of, quote, inspired by alternative ontologies, but still proceeds from spaces entangled with modernism, is fairly obvious. How can it be otherwise? And I suggest that this is the case for all oppositional groups. All oppositional groups, I believe, develop alternative ontologies. Think back, for example, of Ujamaa, developed by Julius Nyerere when Tanzania was throwing off colonialism, and what happened when Ujamaa came up against global capitalism. Finally, I'd like to end with some thoughts about where we go from here. I think it's important to note that despite the challenges, there have been significant victories. The abolitionist movement was perhaps the first transnational progressive movement. The 2001 UN Conference Against Racism was a major advance. It facilitated networking among many of the Afro-descendant groups and as well advanced the study for collective rights among indigenous and Afro-descendant groups. Today, as Charlie points out, Maya are embedded at every level in Guatemala, for better or for worse. Despite ambivalences between Africans and African Americans, collaborative work on anti-colonial struggles, there were five Pan-African conferences leading up to the anti-colonial and liberation of African former colonies. The pressure that was put by Africans on the post-World War II U.S. government that forced them to respond to some of the worst excesses of racism. The anti-apartheid struggle, the UN Conference Against Racism, the cooperation between African-Americans, Africans, and indigenous people in the demands for reparations certainly have been fertile grounds for alliances. And I do have to note on the question of immigration that although it is the case that statistics have demonstrated that in many cases low-level immigrants working at low-level work do take the jobs of some of the poorer or lower level African American and former immigrants, it is nonetheless the case that every major civil rights movement in the United States among African Americans has come out for immigration reform. So despite the condition on the ground, there are principles around human rights to which the population adheres as a result of their own experience. Despite the possible ontological divide, Charlie notes that Rayar, composed of both indigenous and Afro-descended members, has been successful as a loose network exchanging information and support. And to the extent that we are able, through comparative analysis, to analyze the last period, to think about where we are now and to speculate on possible next steps, activist scholarship will have been useful. And I think Charlie would agree that as scholars, we need to think more about the forces that are arrayed against these alliances, these anti-racist alliances, and how some of our work might unwittingly contribute to the strength of these forces. Finally, I want to address, admittedly third hand, Marisol de la Cadena's comment that racism and anti-racist strategies belong to a realm of contestation in modernist ontology and will never yield radical transformation. Again, history tells us that this is to some extent obvious. But I suggest that the conclusion should not be to abandon anti-racist struggle. To my mind, the challenge of anti-racist work is to create a more equitable society across the borders of class, race, gender, and national identity. This was well expressed in the guiding theme of the UN Conference Against Racism in 2001, Global Apartheid, which was notable in, the term global apartheid was notable in providing an analysis that eschewed an essentialist concept of race using the language of political economy that called for the global redistribution of resources. Global apartheid was defined as, quote, an international system of minority rule whose attributes include differential access to basic human rights, wealth and power structured by race and place, structural racism embedded in global economic processes, political institutions, and cultural assumptions, and the international practice of double standards that assume inferior rights to be appropriate for certain others, defined by location, origin, race, or gender. And I think this is a kind of alternative ontology that has a program to it. Anti-racist work is a step, but it is a major step in this process. It is a necessary but not sufficient condition to creating this new type of society. The real challenge is developing a vision of what that society might look like and how to get there. Plural alternative ontologies will be part of this project, but only a part. As Charles suggests, I think what confronts us now as scholars is the analysis of an ever-changing global capitalism and helping to construct a vision for change and a way of getting there.
Queremos mesmo fazer isso que nós estamos esperando, porque não tem nada fechado, nós temos questões e temos procurando direções. Então, eu gostaria de saber quem que quer se manifestar. Eu já vi que o Richard Price levantou a mão. Você quer falar? Então, por favor.
Thinking particularly of Cheryl's and Tim's presentation, I'm wondering how much we lose by talking about categories like African immigration. And as a Caribbeanist, when I think about immigration to New York and racializations that have taken place over the last century, I think of Anglophone West Indians coming in the 20s and 30s from Jamaica and Trinidad and Barbados and the smaller islands, and then later Puerto Ricans coming, Dominicans, then Cubans for the revolution, and then thinking about Haitians and thinking about their places, say in New York, which is what your Cheryl was talking about. It would be very difficult, I think, to generalize and just say Caribbeans, you know, the way you were talking about Africans. And I was thinking about, I haven't lived in the United States for a few years, but my understandings are that Ghanaians have a real sense of community where they are, you know, in the Bronx, and that, and so on and so forth. I'm wondering if the people, someone mentioned Paul Stoller, you quoted him, yeah. And you know, he's dealing with French West Africans who speak a different language when they come. And I'm wondering, in terms of the complexities of relations with African Americans, how different the experience of this wave of recent African immigrants are from very different backgrounds, is, what their experience in terms of their integration or not, and their opposition or solidarity with African Americans, how that's worked. Or whether we can just talk about Africans in general, which I very much doubt.
I think it's a very good question, and I think what we need to start with is remembering what Leith just said about not so much using race as a noun, but looking at the process of racialization. So when we look at, for instance, the early immigration of Puerto Ricans to the United States, there was tension, conflict between Puerto Ricans and white Americans. Over time, they were followed by people from the Dominican Republic and elsewhere in Latin America, and suddenly we saw in the United States Census differentiation between white Hispanics and black Hispanics. So that was reified through the census process. As far as the Africans that we've worked with thus far, yes, they are embedded initially in their own communities. A few men marry out, not very many women, not as many women marry out, but a few men marry out. And again, this depends upon the community. Those that are Muslim from places like Cote d'Ivoire, or Mali, or Senegal, tend to be organized around their own individual mosques. They tend to have imams as particular leaders, and Tim and I have done a little work here, you might expand on that. The Ghanaians tend to be arranged around their churches. And then there's a class difference, as I try to express, between, as Stoller points out, between those people who are working in the informal sector of the economy and really made, like Amadou Diallo, make a lot of money. His mother pointed out that his father and she were millionaires, even though in an American consciousness, they could be more easily victimized by the police because they were seen as street peddlers. And that's a very different kind of thing that those Africans that are entering our Ivy League colleges, et cetera, are looked at. Those that dress in suits or work for IBM or Goldman Sachs, and believe me, there are a lot of them, there are a number of them, are looked at very differently. So I would say that we really do have to focus on the verb racialization, because it means quite a bit of different things for different people. And as far as African Americans themselves are concerned, most people, I would say, look at certain African Americans, like I'll just use Oprah and Jay-Z, sorry. I mean, essentially, they've passed in a different kind of way than most unemployed African Americans are. The most unemployed or uneducated, lowly educated, unskilled workers still, whether they're Latin American or black, are arrested and stopped at 6 times the rate of whites indiscriminately in New York. They are killed at a far higher rate and they are abused in prisons at a far higher rate. So I would say it's a process for everyone comes, and that's why we need to look at it as a verb that happens over time.
I just realized it's not a verb.
It's not a verb, but it's a process.
It's an ongoing process.
Racialized, yes.
Yeah, I agree with what Cheryl said in response in terms of our work in New York with Africans coming in as a very racializing sort of process. But I would also say, just to look at my work in Malaysia and some of the comparative study, that we need to think about the hegemonic structures. I think you're very much correct that on the ground level, everyday relations with people, you know, who are coming in, moving into the society, and also interacting with locals, that is a very dynamic process. I've tried to touch on that in some other sections of the paper. But actually in Malaysia, I don't stay with the category Africans because they're coming from a number of different countries. But locally in Malaysia, they get racialized as Nigerians. They're all lumped into a category of Nigerians, or in local Malaysians terms, Nigerians. And that's hyper-circulated through the media with negative pathological images, as we were talking about earlier. So I think you're right. We don't really stay with that. But we also consider that many of the immigrants themselves, in terms of their identification as they're coming in, they often identify as Africans, even though they're Africans from Nigeria or from Ghana, from Chad. In Malaysia, actually, in terms of the international students, they developed a community where they interacted with each other. They were so excluded from Malaysia. So it was also a part of the racialization process.
I have a question. Eu tenho uma questão que é mais geral, que não é uma questão pontual. O Brasil, pelo menos desde a década de 30, produziu um discurso muito forte de que nós éramos uma nação mestiça e que nós éramos uma democracia racial. E, por conseguinte, nós não precisávamos falar sobre esse assunto. E, mais do que isso, nós temos uma legislação extremamente rigorosa que proíbe qualquer tipo de manifestação racista. Por conseguinte, nós não tínhamos esse problema. Isso chegou a tal ponto que, na década de 70, os militares simplesmente aboliram qualquer pergunta sobre raça no censo. Na década de 70, nós não temos nenhuma informação. Na própria década de 70, o número de livros sobre a questão racial no Brasil podia se contar, provavelmente, nos dedos de uma mão. Era uma não questão. De alguma maneira, os brasileiros quase tinham mais facilidade de falar sobre sexo do que sobre raça. Raça sendo uma coisa incômoda, e raça sendo uma pergunta que deveria ser evitada de qualquer maneira. Então, por exemplo, na seleção de um programa de pós-graduação, se pergunta a idade, se pergunta a residência, renda, para ver se o aluno vai receber uma bolsa, mas perguntar a raça até recentemente poderia ser considerado como um ato racista. Isso mudou drasticamente no Brasil, vocês conhecem bem essa história, e basicamente porque o Brasil tem uma situação muito especial, que é um país que constantemente afirma seu lado africano no futebol, no carnaval, na música, mas quando a gente olha os dados estatísticos, a população não branca, que é mais de 50%, tem os piores índices possíveis. E hoje em dia tem políticas de ações afirmativas, etc. A mesa frisou constantemente a questão de que nós não deveríamos falar de raça, mas nós deveríamos falar da produção de racismo. O Charles falou o tempo inteiro da relação da colonialidade com a questão de raça. Charles falou o tempo inteiro do processo de racialização. Acho que nós temos uma questão que apareceu aqui, apareceu hoje de manhã, que é como nós lidamos com essa categoria. Porque é uma categoria que sim existe, uma categoria que existe no dia a dia. A polícia no Brasil, e o João Pacheco falou sobre isso, atua com os três P's, pobre, prostituta e preto, né, que começa com P. Então, ela existe no dia a dia, ela existe nos dados estatísticos, e ela existe nos movimentos sociais. Quer dizer, como é que esses movimentos vão se organizar se não afirmando seu pertencimento ao grupo? Podemos chamar de raça, de etnia, etc. Então, o que eu acho que teria que ser aprofundado, porque eu não teria nenhuma resposta, é como evitar a racionalização, mas ao mesmo tempo conseguir falar dessa categoria, conseguir construir uma nova ontologia que consiga sair um pouco dessa armadilha que nós estamos um pouco tratando. Eu sei que isso é uma herança muito antiga, mas não basta dizer que, bom, isso é uma herança do colonialismo, estou de acordo. Mas de onde é que a gente vai daqui em diante para conseguir trabalhar? Eu sei que é uma pergunta muito ampla, não estou esperando que vocês tenham respostas definitivas.
Não.
Não,
Seth, we're having trouble here.
You want it?
summary of the question. Oh my. Well, I'll make an attempt.
Maybe you could do it in English because she couldn't hear the translation.
I can summarize one line, and then if you'd like to elaborate, please do. So Brazil, since the 1930s, has had an ideology of racial democracy and a notion of both racial mixture and racial democracy, which led to essentially a prohibition of the category race. So that's during the military dictatorship, the census didn't have a racial category. And in general, the idea, and there's lots of anti-racist legislation, so generally the idea is that in order to combat racism or to affirm the existence of racial democracy, you eliminate the category race. And then there's been this major change in Brazilian society with affirmative action and with the black movement and with the recognition of profound racial inequality. And so we're in this impasse where we're trying to address racism while at the same time affirming affirming what was positive about the elimination of race as a category. Without reproducing, to critique racism without reproducing racialization.
Yeah.
So you want to address this?
So I did my work summarizing the question. No. Well, let me say just two things. What? Everyone wants to say something.
Eu queria complementar uma coisa.
Aham. Uh-huh. Olha com o microfone.
Não, eu
queria complementar só a Rubem, porque não é só a categoria de raça que acabou sendo abolida, mas se a gente pensar em Estado Novo, cadê a categoria étnica?
Sim.
E é? Eu acho que tem que falar também, porque a campanha do nacionalista da época do Getúlio Vargas acabou com tudo, quer dizer, não tinha, era eu.
We are all Brazilians.
Nós somos todos brasileiros e calcada muito na ideologia de vigor dos Estados Unidos, mas que eu acho que conseguiu mais do que nos Estados Unidos, talvez até pela ditadura. Então eu só queria complementar isso. Então é raça e etnicidade. Concorda?
Não. Charlie, now what's the
point? Before, were you okay? We've got the critique and we've got, you know, the kind of other worlds are possible ideas, and I'm being very reductionist, but what are the analytical tools that we use to kind of move us collectively forward? And maybe toward many of these, you know, it's not a direction, but it's many directions. I think there is where the partial connections idea and the kind of the limits of sort of the ontology framework really become important. And so that's where I don't get off the train completely, but I say this is not somewhere where I'm comfortable positioning myself until I'm more convinced of that third element. But I think that's probably